Hello everyone, my name is Dr. M.J. Prince. I am working as assistant professor in Amity University. Today I would like to deliver a lecture on reservoir engineering, and the topic is flow regimes and rock properties. So we will start the introduction like, what are flow regimes, what are the types of flow regimes, which will be the first and which will be the last, what is the purpose of knowing such particular concept. So these are the definitions of flow regimes. One is steady state flow, another one is unsteady state, the third one is pseudo steady state flow. The definition carries like this: the flow regime is identified as steady state flow if the pressure at every location in the reservoir remains constant, does not change with time. And unsteady state flow says, as the fluid flowing condition at which the rate change of pressure with respect to time at any position in the reservoir is not zero. And the pseudo steady state flow says, when the pressure at different locations in the reservoir is declining linearly as a function of time at a constant declining rate, the flowing conditions is characterized as the pseudo steady state flow. So I will be explaining all these kind of flows briefly. First one is steady state flow. Second one is unsteady state flow. Third one is pseudo steady state flow. Before going into this particular three state flows, first of all, you would like we should be knowing the order of these flows, how it will be coming once the reservoir starts to get exploited. Means after like once the production starts, then the engineer will start to drill a well, then he will start to produce oil from subsurface to surface. So once after opening the well, immediately you will be experienced with unsteady state flow. Then after that, because of the water pressure, it will be maintaining very high, so that will make you to experience with steady state flow, and finally the reservoir life will be ended with pseudo steady state flow. First of all, we will be discussing what is unsteady state flow. Unsteady state flow, and it has another name, transient flow. Transient flow. Let us consider our reservoir to be in this direction, in this type of, it is having a shape which is like circular. I am making an ideal reservoir. Then you have drilled a well vertically from subsurface to surface. This is surface. From here you have drilled a well to reach the reservoir. So before drilling this particular well, all the properties inside reservoir are constants. Imagine the pressure at this particular depth. Let us consider that pressure at that target depth is reservoir pressure, and it is expected to be, let us have an ideal value, 2000 psi. So this is the pressure we have experienced once we reached that particular depth. Then once you start drilling over there, there won't be any changes in that particular pressure. At the pressure near to the well, we will be naming it as well bore pressure, that is PW or PWF, flowing well bore, flowing bottom hole flowing pressure. So this particular pressure will be the pressure which will act your flow to come into the well. So first of all, before opening the well, the PWF value also will be 2000 psi. So once after drilling a well and completed with all the completion, second, first, primary and secondary completion, everything, then you are ready to start producing oil from subsurface to surface. Then you are going to perforate near the target zone. So once you start perforating there, then the channels will be generated in deeper into the your reservoir. So once the channels have been generated, then the pressure at near the perforations will be exposed to surface pressure, which is 14.7 psi. But here there will be another drill string will be there, where drilling fluid mud will be there, that will be not allowing the pressure to be dropped from 2000 to 14.7 psi, so that it will start to come abruptly, then there will be a blowout. So drilling mud will be there at least 10 meters above the perforated zone, so that this particular pressure drop over here could be 1990 psi. So 10 psi drop will be experiencing from the target zone of your perforations, as well as to the zone where the oil is going to come. So once 10 psi pressure difference is created, oil will start to flow from reservoir into this particular drill stream like this, with 10 psi pressure difference, like from 2000 psi to 1990 psi. So once oil started to come inside, even the pressure at PWF also will drop to 10 psi. I am giving an ideal values like 1990 psi. So like that, it will be generating like a ripple 1990 psi. So beyond that ripple, the pressure is constant, that is 2000 psi. Then after that, after some time, then this particular ripple will advance into the reservoir like this. So imagine we have different time levels like T1 to TN. Let us consider at a time T1, your reservoir pressure, the PWF value is 1990. When you move from T1 to T2, the reservoir pressure of 1990 will reach here as 1990, and here it will be 1980. This is at T2. Once after again at T3, again the pressure will be advancing towards the reservoir side, and it will be pressure drop will be experienced again. T3, it will be 1970, 1980, 1990, and beyond 1990 it will be 2000 psi. So the pressure difference will be going like a ripple towards the end of your reservoir. Slowly at a particular time it will go and to the edge of your reservoir boundary, and finally it touches your reservoir boundaries. So there is a particular time which has taken this pressure drop to reach from your well to your outer boundaries. That particular time we name it as transient time. So transient time is the time where the pressure drop has started to move from PWF and reaching to the outer boundary. This in duration of this particular transient time, the flow will be constant. It will be experiencing flow as constant. Flow rate will be constant. So that means per 1 hour, if it is producing 10 barrels, means the second hour also it will be expected to produce 10 barrels. So the flow will be constant until it reaches its outer boundary. That particular time we named it as transient time, and the flow rate will be considered to be constant. And this particular condition, the flow experienced during the pressure drop from PWF to the outer boundary, we name that flow as unsteady state flow. And here, whenever time changes, pressure will change. At different locations, pressure also will change. That means dou P by dou T is equal to function of location and time. So the change in pressure, dou P by dou T represents the change in pressure with respect to time, is dependent on, or else it's a function of, I represents location and T represents time. Imagine I will be explaining what is dou P by dou T is equal to F of IT. First of all, I represents location. Let us take a location. Let us take this as a location. let us take one random point located at a reservoir. Imagine, let us take different time levels T1, T2, T3, T4. Let us take a time, this is T1, this is T2, and this is T3. So, at T1, the pressure drop is near to the wellbore. At T2, it has been advanced a little. At T3, it has crossed that particular point. Let us see, when you change the time level, what will be the value of pressure at this particular point. At T2, imagine, at T2, the pressure drop haven't crossed that point. So, at T2, the point value will be 2000 psi. But at T3, the point value will be 1990 psi. That means, before it crosses that particular point at T2, the pressure at that point will be having 2000 psi value. Then after that, after some time, the pressure has dropped to 1990 psi, that is T2 to T3. So this is what, how you are going to explain when you change, when location is constant, when you change time, the value of pressure will change. At the same time, I will explain you, when you change location at different times, will also be different for pressure. Let us imagine, right now we are going to change locations, like that is, one location is here, another location is here, another location is here. So at T1, the pressure drop is here, that is at T1. At T2, the pressure drop is here. At T3, the pressure drop is at here. And at T4, the pressure drop is at here. So this is T1, this is T2, this is T3, this is T4. So let us take the point as x1, x2 and x3. So the value of pressure at x1 will be, imagine, if the value of reservoir pressure value, if it is 2000, the PWF value will start to drop from 2000 psi. So after, at T1, nothing has crossed x1, so the value of x1 at T1 will be 2000. At T1, x1 value will be 2000. At T2, after some time, this particular 2000 psi has crossed x1, and x1 started to reduce to 1990 psi. At T2, the pressure difference has crossed the x1 level, and it reached a little bit advanced, so that the pressure has dropped to 1990 psi. Then after that, when we go to T3, again the pressure has dropped and it will be reaching 1980 psi. That means, if you see different locations, like imagine, when you change time, automatically the location value pressure also will be changing. In the same way, let us see x2. At T1, the value of x2 is 2000 psi. At T2, still it haven't crossed, that will be 2000 psi. Then after that, it will be 1990 psi. When we talk about x3, the value of pressure x3 at T1 is 2000 psi. The value of x3 at T2 is again 2000 psi. The value of T3 is also 2000 psi. So if you could see, at particular time, let us take a time around T2, the pressures will be different everywhere. Whenever you see the location, when you change the location, the pressure will change. When it is considered at T3, all the pressures will be changing. So this is how we are going to explain unsteady state flow condition. Then this is the first experienced flow condition once after drilling the well. Let us move to next stage, that is steady state flow condition. I will be telling you once again, unsteady state flow condition, unsteady state flow condition will be having a condition of change in pressure with respect to time is a function of location and time. Right now we are going to discuss about steady state flow condition. Steady state flow condition is represented as change in pressure with respect to time will be zero. That means there won't be any change in pressure when you change time. The same experiment, we can take it like the same diagram I am drawing, the well, this is the reservoir and this is PWF and all over it is reservoir pressure. So before starting PWF, the pressure was experienced to be 2000 psi, that is PR everywhere is 2000 psi. Okay, then first step is unsteady state flow. That means it started to create pressure ripples among its perforations and until it reached its outer boundary. So the pressure drop can be expected like this: 1970, 1980, 1990, 2000 psi and beyond that. So once after this pressure ripples reaches the outer boundary, it will try to stay static at any time after this particular transient time. When you change time, let us imagine T1, T2, T3, T4. So let us take a location like this. At T1, the value of that location is, imagine the value of location is X1. So X1, at T1, the value is 1990, T2, the value is 1990, T3, the value is 1990, and T4, the value is 1990. So that means there is no change in pressure at that particular location when you change time. That is what the change in pressure with respect to time is equal to zero. Since the pressure is constant, dou P by dou T represents zero. This is what steady state flow represents. This will come immediately after your unsteady state flow condition. Then finally, we will be going to pseudo steady state flow condition. The condition for pseudo steady state is change in pressure with respect to time is constant. The change in pressure with respect to time is constant. See, we have started our flow from unsteady state flow where the pressure drop will be generated near the flowing bottom hole pressure and it will start to spread towards the reservoir until it reaches its outer boundaries. That is unsteady state flow. The flow happened between pressure drop started from PWF and finally it is reaching to outer boundary. That particular flow we will be naming it as unsteady state flow. Then beyond that, the pressures, until the pressure disturbance have been completely created in that drainage area, after that it will be staying as static. It will not reduce or else it will not increase. It will not, the pressure will not get reduced. Then that particular condition we will be naming it as steady state flow. Then finally, this particular condition of steady state flow will happen only because of water drive mechanism. Since water is incompressible fluid, it can hold oil to stay for long time. So that will make the flow to be steady. Then after that, once the water energy have been dropped, then the pressure slowly it will also start to decline. And the decline rate also will be constant. Imagine, let us have different time levels, T1, T2, T3, T4. If let us take the same location as X1. So if you see at T1, the pressure value, if it is 1990, then at T2, the pressure value will be 1980. At T3, the pressure value will be 1970. And at T4, the pressure value will be 1960. Means at every time level, the pressure drop is 10 psi. Every time level, the pressure drop is 10 psi. So the pressure drop is constant. So that is what the change in pressure with respect to time is equal to constant. Why? Because the reduction of pressure is constant. The change in pressure itself is constant. So that represents the equation dou p by dou t as constant. So all together I will be putting in a graph so that it will be understood where exactly the life of reservoir starts and then it ends. PWF versus time in years. So the life of reservoir we will be measuring in years. So I already told you before perforations the value of PWF will be equal to PR, from 0 to PR. Then let us imagine that as 2000 psi. From there itself the pressure will start to slowly drop. So if you could see this may come up to here as unsteady state flow, unsteady. Then after that the drop will be maintained up to some extent where the pressure will not have any difference, that will be steady state flow. Then finally after that constant declination, that will be pseudo steady state flow. The lifespan of unsteady state flow and pseudo steady state flow is comparatively with steady state flow they were big. So steady state flow will be having very much low life compared to unsteady and pseudo steady. Okay, this is how the flow regimes will be affected inside a well. That is, one is unsteady, that is the one which will be starting, then after that it will be followed by steady state and pseudo steady. Rock properties. This rock represents reservoir rock, and this is the rock where crude oil will be stored. Before exploiting any reservoir rock, we should be understanding the properties of that particular rock. That is, one is porosity, permeability, saturation, wettability, surface and interfacial tension, capillary pressures and rock compressibilities. I will be explaining each property in briefly. Porosity. So porosity is a term which we will be using much in reservoir engineering, and it is having a symbol of phi. This is the symbol we are going to say for porosity, and it can be defined as pore volume by bulk volume. So it is a ratio that will be represented as pore volume by bulk volume. Pore volume represents the pore spaces which were present inside a reservoir rock where the oil will be accumulated, and the bulk volume represents, apart from pore spaces, there will be grain volume will be there, pore spaces plus grain volume, all together we will be naming it as bulk volume. Pore volume by pore volume plus grain volume, so this will be given as porosity. So this is very important property to understand the type of reservoir rock, how much volume it is withholding oil inside. Imagine for sandstone and limestone, these are the major reservoir rocks we have been encountered. Then the limestone will be having less porosity compared to sandstone. So sandstone may have porosity from 20% to 35%, and limestone will be having porosity 15%, and then it will be less than that. But the oil which was accumulated inside limestone, it is not based on porosity, but that will be based on permeability, that will happen with fractures. So this is what exactly porosity is. Then let us go to the another property, that is permeability. This is one of the most important properties for reservoir engineering. What is the meaning of permeability? Permeability means it is an ability of a reservoir rock to allow a fluid to bypass through it. So actually every reservoir will be having indefinite shape, and it is not like that it has to collect oil, but it should be like it has to have a property to flow that oil to one particular side to another side. That is what exactly. Imagine this is a reservoir rock which is having grains, and it should be having a bypass route so that oil can be bypassed from one particular area to another particular area. So that this is like oil, it will be bypassed through capillary tubes. Capillary tubes represents smaller pores, and there will be larger pores are there where oil will be accumulated. Through capillary pores, oil will be bypassed from one particular area to another particular area. Imagine if the capillary pores were locked, if there is no chance of oil to bypass through that capillary pores, then permeability is considered to be zero. A high porosity reservoir which doesn't have permeability is not at all favorable condition for a reservoir engineer to extract oil. So you should make it more permeable so that oil can be extracted easily. So, and I will be giving you the definition for permeability. There is a scientist named Darcy. Darcy is the scientist who has defined the value of permeability to be K represents permeability, Q mu L by A del P. K represents permeability, Q represents flow rate of oil, mu represents viscosity of oil, L represents length or height of the reservoir, A represents cross-sectional area of the reservoir, and delta P represents pressure change between one place to another place where it will be moved. Then let us go to another property, that is saturations. Saturations is a property of every reservoir, and it is unique. Like altogether the saturations we will be naming, imagine saturation of oil is SSO, saturation of water is SW. So for every reservoir, the complete saturations will be considered to be 100%, that is 1. SO plus SW is equal to 1. A reservoir, either it should carry oil or else water. If that is the case, SO is equal to 1 since SW is equal to 0, which will not happen. So always a reservoir, naturally every reservoir is wetted by water, so that it carries a little bit amount of water by itself, which cannot be extracted. That particular water we name it as connate water saturation. So wherever you, if you consider a reservoir, the saturation, the sum of saturations will be always considered to be 100%. SO plus SW is equal to 1. There is one more composition, that is SO plus SG plus SW is equal to 1. SG represents gas. So this gas saturation also will accumulate inside the whole saturations, that will make it to 1. Whether if gas is not there, then SO plus SW is equal to 1. If gas is there, then SG plus SO plus SW is equal to 1. Then let us go for another property, that is wettability. Wettability is a property of reservoir rock which will have an attraction towards a particular fluid, either it may be polar or non-polar. So polar represents water, non-polar represents oil. Polar, non-polar. So reservoir, if any reservoir was done a geological experiment, first of all they will be trying to find out what type of reservoir is like regarding to wettability, whether it is oil wet or water wet, or else there is another state is there, that is intermediate. So oil wet represents the reservoir is much attracted towards organic parts. If it is water wet, that is like much it is attracted towards polar parts, like which is soluble in water. When it is intermediate, it has a property to attract water as well as with oil. So that is the type of wettabilities we will be seeing in laboratory experiments, whether which type of reservoir it is regarding to wettability. And then next we will be going to surface tension and interfacial tension. Surface tension, it can be defined as the tension between solid and any other fluid like solid and gas or else solid and liquid. Let us take an example like solid and liquid. Since the surface between solid and gas will be very much narrow, so let us take a solid and below that there is like this is solid, above there is a liquid medium is there. So the attraction between solid and liquid at the surface will be named it as surface tension. Imagine if surface tension, let us take when there is a rain, if you could observe leaves, the water will be falling like droplets because of surface tension. Why? Because that a leaf is having a property to attract water droplets towards its surface. So this particular surface tension we will be measuring inside the reservoir rock. So this surface tension will also help us to identify whether the reservoir rock is oil wet or water wet. Then let us go to interfacial tension. Interfacial tension is the tension which was generated between two immiscible fluids. Interfacial tension. So the tension, imagine there is two mediums are there. One is oil and water. See, both oil and water at high pressures, they will be compressed and they will be tensed together. It cannot be separated that easily because of interfacial tension which was present at the interface between oil and water. Then let us go for capillary pressures. Next property of reservoir rock is capillary pressures. Capillary pressure has a simple definition, that is capillary pressure, if it is a PC, then it can be defined as the difference between non-wetting phase pressure and wetting phase pressure. Non-wetting phase pressure, imagine if wetting phase is water, then not in non-wetting phase will be oil. So the pressure between non-wetting phase and wetting phase pressure, the difference between these two will be considered as capillary pressures. And finally, we will go for rock compressibility. Rock compressibility. Compressibility, every reservoir rock has a property to be compressed at heavy high pressure which was there from the surface. It will make from overburden pressure will make a reservoir rock to get compressed. So while how much it has been compressed, that we have to calculate. Why? Because when you reduce pressure, the compression will become into expansion. In that way, oil will be expelled from reservoir rock to other places. So compressibility of a reservoir rock can be taken it as change in volume with change in pressure when there is change in volume. So dou V by dou P into 1 by V. So change in volume, when you change pressure to reduce for 1 PSA or something, that can be defined as compressibility. So we have discussed about today regarding to flow regimes, where there are three types of flows were there. One is unsteady, and then next comes steady state flow, and then finally it will be ending with pseudo steady state flow. Once you start drilling a well, you will be experiencing with unsteady state flow, then it will be followed by steady state, and finally the life of well will be ended by unsteady pseudo steady state flow. Then after that, we have discussed about rock properties. There are different properties are there which has to be known to extract crude oil. That is porosity, permeability, saturations, wettability, surface and interfacial tension, capillary pressures and rock compressibilities. Once you, if you could able to have good idea on these particular properties and flow regimes, then that will help us to get a good idea to prepare a plan to extract how oil can be extracted in a proper way. Thank you for this lecture, sir.